My name is David Gosset. I am the founder of the China Europe America Global Initiative. And I wish a good afternoon to the friends in China, good morning to the friends in Europe. And I would like to welcome all, of course, the friends joining us from the Americas. We had a great first day yesterday in the framework of our third dialogue of the China, Europe, America Museums Cooperation Initiative. And today we continue the conversation. We are very happy. We, on our side, we are at Nankai University in the beautiful city of Tianjin. And I would like to thank all those in Nankai supporting our work today. From one school, we go to another great school, a French school whose name is EM Lyon. And it's a great honor for me to introduce Professor William Wang, the Dean of EM Lyon Asia Pacific, a friend of strong support of the China, Europe, America Global Initiative. And I know that with you, Professor, we are in good hands. So thank you very much to you, to your school, for your support. And the floor is yours to chair the first session of our second day. Thank you, Professor.
非常感谢高大伟先生。首先做一下自我介绍，我是王华法国里昂商学院副校长，里昂商学院亚洲校区校长。 华东师范大学亚欧商学院法方院长，当然我也是中欧美全球倡议理事会的成员。我们今天这个分论堂二探讨的话题呢，是科技对博物馆的影响。我们也知道啊，这个科技正在深刻的影响着博物馆。那么如何借助科技的力量，使博物馆为促进文化的交融 合作来做出贡献，这是我们今天来探讨的主题。当然，本人作为一个博物馆的爱好者和参访者，我已经体验到在不少的博物馆当中，有更多的博物馆在借助数字的方式来更为立体的介绍自己的藏品，甚至于包括在参访者结束了博物馆的参访之后，对博物馆的衍生品 未来的活动的介绍与消费者进行着持续的连接。那么本次的论坛呢，我们非常荣幸的邀请到五位中外嘉宾，那么他们分别是西班牙克里斯托弗格朗博物馆和哥布朗基金会的负责人约翰哥布朗先生，天津博物馆馆长姚阳先生，亚洲数字艺术 展的出品人王鹏先生，平面设计师Tisinari Vita 设计工作室的负责人保罗塔西纳里先生，以及建筑师 Civic Workshop 创始人安东 西比克先生。那么在这个接下来的环节呢，每一位我们的嘉宾都有8分钟的时间来表达自己的真知灼见。那首先呢，请约翰·哥布朗先生，他呢是现任哥布朗基业亚洲有限公司的执行董事，他也拓展了哥布朗基金会在美国和亚洲分布的相关的这个业务。Mr. Juan Gabaron, the floor is yours.
Hello and happy International Museums Day and Museums Night. We just celebrated this special day and night in Spain and Germany with our current 6 exhibitions among our museum, public spaces, and collaboration exhibitions in other museums. Overall, new technologies have the potential to enable museums to better fulfill their missions, engage new audiences, and create innovative new forms of cultural exchange and dialogue. However, it's important to recognize that these technologies also bring new challenges and ethical considerations, and museums will need to carefully consider how best to integrate new technologies into their operations and programs while maintaining their core values and responsibilities. Before we address the question of how technology can foster the role of museums as creators of cultural convergence, we need to be aware of the current challenges so we can realize the impact of technology in a more holistic way. These are some of the museum's challenges today. Number one, educational challenges. Despite of growing museums in the world, there is a decline in attendance for youth, roughly 1% decline per year since 2002 in the age group of 18 to 24, that is at rate 15% in 2017. In order to engage with young audiences, we must create digital highways so they can connect with us more. Otherwise, sooner or later, the traditional museums will start to disappear. Number two, the structural issues. The growing diversity of visitors challenge the museums to adapt and deliver different experiences to each of them according to their diversity profile. The shipping costs are a new challenge to exchange exhibitions, pushing more into alternative solutions like virtual exhibitions. With the technology evolution growing exponentially, the information and changes in our society are also accelerating more and more. This means museums have to adapt faster. The size and locations, with expanding cities and populations, is more difficult for people to visit from distance location. People also have less time to visit museums. These new models of population distribution affects our museums regarding change of size, location, and even our model itself. Number three, identity issues. With a society driven by technology, the next revolution to disrupt will probably be the metaverse. In a growing virtual world, there are a huge investment in digital land, where most likely people will visit shops, entertainment, and of course, new museums. Let me mention a few. There are several virtual lands and platforms that have gained significant attention and value in recent years, particularly in the context of blockchain-based virtual worlds. These include Decentraland. Users can buy and own virtual land within the world and use it to create and share content with other lands. The price of virtual land for a 10 by 10 meter parcel is around $10,000. Other blockchain-based virtual worlds are Sandbox and Somnium. This virtual world gives us a new dilemma regarding the museum's mission, channels, programs, and even physical presence that will change drastically very soon. Worth to mention, there is not yet an important museum with presence in this metaverse platform. Number four, issues with the frontiers. For centuries, museums were almost exclusively the keepers of art and cultural heritage. Now these frontiers of these keepers are bluer because new players like galleries, art fairs, and new ways of art entertainment, in particular the digital art, gigantic immersions, that young audiences are attending massively. Examples of these are Team Lab from Japan has already expanded to Dubai, Miami, Shanghai, San Francisco, Barcelona. Superblue, which is present in Miami and London, Atelier de Lumières in France, Frameless in London, Area 15 in Las Vegas, to just to name a few. As we can see, there are complex challenges for museums today. So now let's talk about what we can do with creativity and the technological tools within reach. Number one, use immersive technology. Like the ones we talked before, develop a visual storytelling in a very appealing way to the audience. Number two, use digital 360 environments with VR goggles, phones, and tablets, and websites. The Gavran Foundation is using this technology since the COVID and deliver experiences in museums, galleries, as well as public art installations. Number three, gaming. Nowadays, this industry is 5 times bigger than the film industry, and they are growing at 2% digits every year with $200 billion USD revenues. Therefore, it's a tool with massive potential for cultural institutions by creating games to deliver museums content. Number four, there are a number of new emerging tools in artificial intelligence, AI, that museums are beginning to use to enhance the visitor experience and streamline operations, especially since last November, with the disruption of ChatGPT by OpenAI. Here are the most important tech tools and uses. A, enhancing the visitor experience. Museums are already beginning to use technologies like virtual and augmented reality, chatbox, and predictive analytics to enhance the visitor experience. Some apps that we can try are TARS, a chatbot platform that can be used to create custom conversational experiences for a variety of use cases, including museum exhibitions. Dialogue flow can be used to create custom conversational experiences for museum visitors. B, augmented reality, AR. AR technology can be used to enhance exhibitions by overlaying digital information and interactive elements on top of the physical objects. For example, visitors can use AR apps to see what an exhibition looked like in a different time of period, or to access additional information about a particular object. Examples of this technology is Aurasma, uses image recognition technology to trigger digital content, such as videos, 3D models, and animations, when visitors scan specific objects or locations with their smartphones. Another app, Blipper, uses machine learning technology to create AR experiences that are tailored to individual visitors based on their interests and preferences. C, facial recognitions. Museums are experimenting with facial recognition technology to personalize the visitor experience. For example, a facial recognition system could recognize a returning visitors and provide them personalized recommendations based on their past interests and preferences. Examples of this technology are Amazon Recognition, a facial recognition service that can be used to identify and analyze faces in images and videos. Another is Kairos, another facial recognition platform that can be integrated with mobile apps and kiosks. D, predictive analytics. Museums can use predictive analytics to better understand visitors' behavior and preferences, and to make data-driven decisions about exhibitions design and programming. For example, by analyzing data and visitors' demographic and behavior, museums can identify which exhibitions are more popular and make adjustments to improve the visitor experience. Examples of the technology, we have Google Analytics, a web analytics service that can be used to track visitors' behavior and engagement on museum websites and mobile apps. Museums can use Google Analytics to identify trends and patterns in visitors' behavior, which can inform exhibition design and content development. Another software is IBM Watson that museums can use to analyze visitors' data, such as demographic information and exhibitions interactions, to make predictions about future behavior and preferences. E, object recognitions. Object recognition technology can be used to help visitors identify and learn about specific objects in a museum's collection. By using a smartphone or other device to scan an object, visitors can access a digital information about its history, significance, and cultural context. Examples of this technology are Google Cloud Vision, an image recognition platform that can be used to identify and analyze objects and images and videos. Museums can use Cloud Vision to create interactive exhibitions that respond to specific objects, such as providing additional information or triggering digital content. Amazon Recognition, in addition to facial recognition, it can also be used for object recognition. F, other uses of technology more adopted already are digitizing collections, advancing research with machine learning and artificial intelligence, and addressing conservation challenges with new technologies like 3D printing. My closing remark will be that it's clear, I think, in my talk, that the huge potential of technology for museums. So I encourage all of you to experiment in your museums and institutions with the latest tools to deliver innovation. Even if some experiment will fail, it will give us a crucial edge. The sooner we can anticipate the new changes and innovate in new ways to deliver our mission, the more engaged the audience and visitors we will have. Many technologies will fade away, but we cannot afford to miss the next wave of new technologies. Thank you.
感谢 Sean Gabaron 先生啊，我们知道 museum 啊，这个博物馆它首先的存在就是有一个具体的物理的空间。当我们听到说我们的这个消费者每一年如果是1%逐年的下降的话，那当然是值得我们的博物馆相关从业人员值得警示的一个关注点。当然他也提到了未来包括 AI 人工智能ChatGPT 等等诸多的相关的技术如何能够赋能我们的博物馆的这个相关的业务啊，也包括和我们的消费者之间的消费行为偏好有更为明确的这个了解。我想在未来这些博物馆的从业人员能够更多的来借助技术 来为目前的现有的这个相关的艺术来做好更多的和未来消费者的互动，这是一个非常重要的一个话题。好，再次感谢。那么接下来呢，我们有请姚洋先生啊，他曾经就读于南京大学，先后呢也获得了法学的学士、历史学的硕士、博士学位，并为该校的文学院在中国古典文学博士后，也历任李叔同故居纪念馆馆长、天津博物馆副馆长、天津市文化遗产保护中心主任。那他现任呢是天津博物馆馆长啊。我们现在有请姚洋先生来分享他就这个话题啊跟我们的一些探讨。好，姚洋先生，有请。
尊敬的各位嘉宾，这个非常荣幸啊，接受这个邀请来探讨有关科技与文化融合的话题。那么我来自天津博物馆，天津博物馆呢，这个成立在1918年，到现在是105年。那么我们这个博物馆呢，现在是拥有21万件这样的各类型文物的一个收藏量，那么涵盖了像陶瓷、这个古代的书法、绘画、甲骨，包括金银器、玺印等等各个主要的这种文物类别。那么谈到这个科技力量与文化融合之间的关系呢，我想呢，文化的融合首先是基于不同类的文化之间的一种认识和理解。博物馆呢是以物来见人，那么通过作为这种文化物质的重要印记的我们的各类的收藏品，它可以直观的去向观众来传递文化的某些的要素或者是特点。这是我们博物馆在实现文化传播与融合之这个方面的一个有利的因素。但是呢，博物馆在文化的传播融合促进方面也存在着一定的局限性，就是说我们的文物的藏品所传达的信息是往往是不全面不完整的，甚至它是一种碎片化的啊，特别是相对于文化系统的整体而言，它可能传递的信息只是其中的一个面或者一个点。那么如果我们试图的去通过有限的文物来去了解或者解读文化的全貌，那么无疑我想是相当困难的。那么特别是作为文化系统组成中的一些重要方面，比如说我们文化产生的这个起源发展的脉络，以及在特定时期的这种生产生活的方式和历史背景，那么我们也很难通过有限的文物去达到一种明确而全面的认知。但是我想科技的力量是可以帮助我们在一定程度上来解决这个问题。那么借助各类的这个数字化的技术手段，那我们现在可以在博物馆的展览中去还原一些特定文物产生的过程，或者是它们产生的这种历史文化的背景啊，以及这些文物这个展品相关的历史功能，从而去帮助观众看到他们的人去加深对文物展品的这种内涵与价值的理解。比如说我们天津博物馆现在正在举办的一个典型性的一个重要展览，叫中国古代音乐文物展。那么在这个展览当中呢，我们展出了200余件的中国各个历史时期的代表性的音乐文物。但是呢，其中的一些重要的古代的乐器，比如说像编钟、铙等等，那么他们在现代社会中呢早已经不再使用了啊，现代的人对他们的这个功能、他们的演奏方式以及发出的声音都是很陌生的。因此呢，如果说我们只是通过看文物的形式，对他们是无法形成全面的了解的。因此我们在博物馆中，在展览当中，就是利用到现在沉浸式的数字化的这种技术手段，去打造了一面知音墙。那么观众呢，不仅可以在这个数字化的知音墙上去比较直观的全方位的去观察这些古代的音乐文物，它们的全貌以及细部的一些特征， 还可以通过触碰的方式来进行实现影像的变化，向观众去展示这些古代音乐文物当年他们的功能，他们的打击或者演奏的这些方式，还有让观众可以直观的去聆听他们发出美妙的这种声音，从而使观众呢能够对他们的历史功能、他们的文化价值有最直接的了解。这是我想说的第一方面。第二个在想说的呢，就是说文化的融合关键在于人啊，这个文化信息的接收、它的传递、它的融合的根源是在于人。那么对于博物馆来说呢，青少年始终是我们重点关注的人群，他们是文化信息传递的一个重要的力量。那么刚才这个前面的馆长也提到了啊，传统的博物馆的这个教育方式相对于现代当代的这个年轻人来说，是我个人觉得是缺乏足够的吸引力的。这就需要说我们去借助科技的力量来弥补这方面的不足啊，比如在我们天津博物馆，我们现在是比较广泛的采用了这种 AR、MR 等等的相关的技术，以及相关数字化的影像，去加强青年人对特定文化环境的这种代入感，让他们尽可能的以身临其境的这种感受方式来提高对文化背景的理解，增强他们去接受文化和传播文化的这种兴趣。那么再有呢，就是除了了解和认知以外，我认为文化融合的另一个关键在于不同的文化之间的有效沟通，以及相关的文化信息的传播与分享。那么我们多年以来也曾经举办过多个这种高水平的外国的文化历史主题展啊，比如涉及到的有古埃及文明、古罗马文明、地中海文明和非洲文明等等。那么在这些展览当中，我们也比较多的去运用到了科技的手段，来尽量的去减少或者叫抵消这种文化或者文明间的地域隔阂感。比如2018年天津博物馆和意大利的有关的博物馆就共同举办了这个庞贝古城的出土文物的精品展。那么我们的观众市民在展览的过程中，他们可以欣赏到庞贝古城那些精美的文物，但是同时呢，对于这个古城的消失，对于这种文明的消失，我们中国的观众是并不能是完全去理解的。那么我们在这个展览中呢，也就设计了一个空间，那不仅去复原了当时庞贝古城它的历史生活的原貌，同时也用数字化的手段复原展现，就是火山爆发、古城消灭消失的那一瞬间的这个情景，让观众能够更直接去感受这个文化文明消亡的一个过程，从而产生一种文化上的情感共鸣。同时呢，我们这些年一直也坚持利用数字化的科技手段对馆藏的文物进行信息化的采集和使用而且通过建设我们的网上博物馆以及借助我们的手机以及各类的媒体终端平台，逐步去发展发布这些藏品的图像的信息，来使这个中国的不同的城市、不同的地域，包括国外的观众，那么不论这个远近，都可以去分享到这种科技信息化带来的成果达到文化传播理解的一个功能最后呢，我想说就是参观博物馆，参观博物馆中的藏品是人们了解不同文化的最直观、最便捷的途径。但是人们在面对文物藏品，从而实现文化理解和文化融合的过程中，可能需要一种有效的理解和连接的纽带在物和物、物、物与物、物与文化之间也存在着这个缝隙，那么需要有一种力量来进行填充。那我相信呢，这个科技能够达到来发挥纽带填充作用的是一种重要的力量。好，谢谢。
好，感谢姚洋先生您刚才讲这个科技怎么样让以物见人这件事情能够变得更为的立体通过多媒体的方式来进行互动，而且关注青少年新这个他们的这个消费方式。 通过 AR/MR 等等形式来给我们的这个未来的这个文化消费者啊，能够有更好的这个体验，都是非常有借鉴意义。啊，我们下面呢，下一位的这个嘉宾啊，是我们王鹏先生啊。那王鹏先生呢，是北京唐颖仲建文化传播有限责任公司的执行董事，也是荣一数字文化发展中心理事长，中国国际商会文化和旅游产业委员会的常委，政协北京市海淀区第十一届委员会的委员，中关村文化产业新领军十大创新人物。那有请王鹏先生跟我们分享一下啊，因为确实在过往的过程当中，您也做了与这个亚洲数字艺术相关等等，比更多的一些技术、数字、表演等等这些融合的一些经验啊，有请。
好，大家下午好。我现在其实就在那个敦煌，然后因为正好在出差，我们和敦煌有一个交流的活动，也是非常荣幸我们这次受邀能够参加到文明对话之桥的这个活动里啊。那我刚才其实主持人感谢主持人的介绍，那我是作为亚洲数字艺术展的出品人，然后我们呢确实在数字文化在文化科技融合方面呢做了一些工作，也是这几年呢可能有一些积累。那其实今天也是借着这个平台也跟大家一方面我觉得是分享亚洲数字艺术展，同时另外呢其实也是聊聊文化科技融合。那当然亚洲数字艺术展在我们从2019年开始到现在呢已经连续举办了4年，到今年已经是进入了第5年。那我想我们这5年来呢其实也确实有了一些积累和一些体会。那我们觉得文化和科技的融合呢在这几年其实不断的发生着各种各样的新的变化和一些新的化学反应，然后呢大家可能在这中间也找到了一些创新的模式。那比如说基于区块链技术在我们的展览中就有所应用。当然了我们也在数字艺术方面我们可能也在这几年也参与了很多大型的有影响力的活动，比如说去年的北京的冬奥会，比如说在乌镇举办的世界互联网大会，那都有在我们团队都有参与到其中的文化科技融合和数字文化方面的这个展览和展示的一些相关的工作。那当然我觉得可能来到这个数字的时代啊，那我觉得现在大家来到数字时代，然后也是到 Web3.0 的时代，元宇宙的这个新的业态的出现，那我们也在一步一步去完善。除了数字艺术展之外，我们也参与到一些数字化的一些展演出，包括这个数字文创的平台的打造。那2019年的5月15号呢，是在北京举办了一件比较重要的事情，就是亚洲文明对话大会。那我想，亚洲文明对话大会呢，其实是一个特别典型代表性的文明交流互鉴的这样一个项目。那5月15日亚洲文明对话大会开幕。然后国家主席习近平其实当时发表了深化文明交流互鉴共建亚洲命运共同体的主旨演讲。那当然次日呢也就是5月16号，就是我们亚洲数字艺术展的亮相和开幕。在这个文化嘛，在国际的交往中呢其实发挥了不可替代的作用，那大家其实感受都比较深。那特别是来到了数字经济的时代，那作为文化交往升级形式的这个数字文化越来越这个受到大家的重视。那我想这个重视其实一定是来自全世界的重视，可能不单单是在中国，在亚洲，也在世界各地都会越来越被重视。2019年的6月，在北京当时其实近100位的外国的驻华使节当时来到亚洲数字艺术展现场参观。我们当时呢除了展览之外也在展览现场参观了一场比较独特的时装秀。其实这种时装秀呢就更多的是把中国的传统文化的内容与数字化的影像的呈现去做了结合，那其实就让观众能够感受到有一点就是在仿佛在置身梦境之中哈。那当然这会儿的数字文化的交融其实就超越了文明的隔阂。那2021年的10月，在迪拜举办了这个迪拜世博会。 那我们亚洲数字艺术展也推出了相关的数字艺术作品，在迪拜向世界各国展示了数字文中国的文化成果。所以一直以来我们也积极发挥数字文化的创新体验和突破时空限制的这么一个特点，助力了全球的数字文明交流互鉴走向深入。那当然在亚洲数字艺术展作为文化交流，为文化交流搭建了更国际化的这样一个平台，也聚集了世界各地的数字艺术的人才的关注。数字文化的创新表达丰富了各国文明表达的这个语汇，拉近了各国人民的这个心灵距离。那当然亚洲数字艺术展截止目前呢，刚才介绍其实我们已经举办了4年，一直是以这几年呢都是以包括生态文明包括算力算法等不同的主题，也吸引了来自世界各地近200多个艺术家和数字艺术的团队参与到我们这个项目过程中。那当然我们除了可能有200多个团队参与的展览中，另外我们也做了作品的全球征集。那全球征集呢其实会吸引了更多的年轻人参与到我们的这个项目中。其实可能未必是一个艺术家的身份，更多的是一个创作者。所以全球的青年其实已经是可以说数字时代的青年已经是来到这个是相当于现在的青年其实就是数字的一代。那我们以全球作品征集的这种形式呢，实际上把青年人又凝聚在一起，然后来自全球包括亚洲欧洲美洲大洋洲的创作者以数字艺术的语言然后齐聚在我们亚洲数字艺术展这个平台上共话文明美好愿景。其实我们也会坚持哈，将持续去发挥平台作用，为全球青年架设沟通的桥梁，谱写各美其美、美美与共的文明华章。那今年呢，其实我们会更加聚焦科技艺术的协同发展、协同增量，特别是关注青少年走进数字艺术。那我们说这个走进呢，一方面可能是像走进美术馆、走进博物馆、走进艺术馆。那另外其实我们说的走进还有一种可能其实就是参与更多的青年参与到数字艺术和文化科技融合艺术这个形态的创作中来，因为这种创作形式越来越开放也越来越多样，特别是在现在进入数字时代之后，大家可能越来越开始关注我们公众的数字素养的提升。那我想通过文化和艺术的方式去提升数字素养可以说是更容易沁入人心的一种方式。那我们也当然也会就像今年的这个博物馆日的国际博物馆日的主题一样哈，那我们以亚洲数字艺术展为代表的这个数字文化的项目致力于不断的去充分的技术和文化内容的融合。那我们也希望能够共同携手呢，以这个共同共建可持续性和美好生活的这么一个愿景吧，然后共同来去做这件事儿。所以我想刚才介绍这些呢其实可能更多的是谈到我们亚洲数字艺术展这几年来的一些经历和收获心得。但是我想其实也同时我们也希望就今天正好是我们去年呢在乌镇的世界互联网大会上有一个当时的成果的露出，也是我们作为携手构建网络空间命运共同体文化网络文化交流板块的一个成功案例。那我想今天正好又是在2023年呢乌镇世界互联网大会也发出了这样一个这个今年乌镇峰会的这个携手构建网络空间命运共同体的这个征集的一个这个活动，也希望能够其实包括今天参与到我们沙龙活动里以及其他的一些朋友更多的朋友能够参与到这个征集中，我想其实也会从中有对这个文化科技融合有了更多的理解和帮助吧。啊，谢谢主持人。
好非常感谢王鹏先生啊，您在这个短短的8分钟之内聚焦谈了这个亚洲数字艺术展，而且呢也再次的提及了青少年这样一个人群以及技术给我们带来的这个未来潜在的这个变化。正如我们的第一位嘉宾Joan Gabaron也在他的演讲当中提到，确实有一个平行世界正在诞生啊，在元宇宙的这个时代，我们也可以看到艺术的创造者和艺术的这个欣赏者 之间的边界变得越来越模糊啊，类似于像 Mid Journey 这样的这些人工智能软件的这个工具的运用啊，是确实是使得这样的一种边界在变得更为的模糊。您也提到了这个数字文明和这个数字文化这样的一些概念的这个共建，我相信啊，从底层的角度来讲，艺术的平权由于科技的力量，使得我们会在未来的文化艺术的数字化的创作的过程当中，会发生了一种结构性的一个变化啊。再次向您表示感谢。那我们下一位嘉宾呢是Paolo Tassinari 啊，他是于1981年联合创立了工作室 Tassinari Vita 啊，他担任国际建筑杂志Casabella 艺术总监的超过20年。那么现在呢也担任意大利顶尖的这个高等教育机构SISSA 的客座教授，并在文化部门呢也担任公共的这个职务。那我们接下来有请 Paolo Tassinari， Mr. Paolo Tassinari， the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon and good morning. My name is Paolo Tassinari, and I am.Addressing you from Italy. As a graphic designer, I spent some 40 years working mainly in design for culture, dealing with different media and technologies, but always understanding design as process. Speaking about museums and technologies, I would like to draw your attention to a very unique kind of communication technology.Widely used in the cultural sector, that is namely writing. We have to acknowledge that 5,000 years after its invention, writing is still one of the most powerful means of communication available to us. From handwriting to epigraphy, from typography to digital, writing is still at the center of the world, of our world.Together with its rules and shapes. So, please let me share some images. The first stop of our short journey into communication for cultural heritage will then be at the center, in the heart of Rome.The Vittoriano complex is named after Vittorio Emanuele, the first monarch of unified Italy. It was built between 1880 and 1910. It symbolizes the history and identity of Italy, and it hosts the monument to the unknown soldier. The gentleman in the foreground is the president of the Italian Republic, descending the altar of the fatherland all by himself,after a ceremony during the COVID-19 lockdown in 2020. On the left, the Vittoriano, and on your right side, you can see Palazzo Venezia, the residence of popes during the Renaissance, an important museum of fine and applied arts, and also the seat of the government during the fascist years. The two landmarks,are connected now in a new institution called VIVE, V-I-V-E. And I quote from the mission statement, the Institute, a symbol of a republic and its constitutional values, protects and enhances its architecture, its decorative elements and its collection, primarily through research and study.The Institute also promotes the public use with a view to a full and modern education towards an active, democratic, and European citizenship. So, as designer in charge of the new visual identity, our task is to connect two very different entities so as to make them speak with one voice. And just like every voice has its timbre,Every writing has its own form. Civium libertati, patriae unitati, a commitment to the freedom of the citizens, to the unity of homeland. Out of many others on the building, these two inscriptions are the starting point in our typographical research. Two different typefaces tell us of different ages, whereas the matching proportions of design, they both belong to the same so-called typeface family, allow the two syllables to coexist harmoniously. Color and texture palettes, inspired by the building and its historical frieze, complement the graphic apparatus, resulting in a subtle and dynamic visual environment. Our visual communication language shall be able to fill gaps, language, culture gaps, among all. It shall be able to act as a bridge. We will speak a contemporary language with the roots in our past. We will be open and inclusive. These are our principles, and we design this way. Typography can take the leading role too. In Brescia, the historical city in northern Italy, Vittoria Alata 2020 is a cultural project aimed to transform the restoration of the city's iconic Roman statue into an opportunity for civic growth. A new setup for the statue in a renovated museum, but also a 2-year program of events that in the end proved to be the engine of post-pandemic recovery through culture. For us as designers, an opportunity to draw an open program of visual identity and cultural communication. I never saw anything more beautiful as the word of a renowned scholar speaking of the incredible Roman bronze statue just come to light during excavation of the Capitolium in Brescia in 828. Unfortunately, at the time that we start designing, or thankfully maybe, the beautiful object of communication is not available, being under restoration in the Opificio delle Pietre Dure in Florence. So we start working on a 3D scientific model with the aim to develop and contemporary iconography from it. Classical beauty and scientific imaging evolved together into a contemporary and accessible visual language open to improvisation, as in a contemporary musical score. From posters to low market merchandising or post stamps, they all cooperate to create a unique visual environment to enhance the identity of the city and the spirit of the space. These are part of our principles, and with the design this way. Thank you.
Sinari 先生啊，您刚才通过 VIVE 这样的一个真实的案例向我们展示如何能够把历史包括这个最为经典的艺术作品和当代的审美现代化的表达能够来做了一个非常这个完美的一个演绎啊，这我相信啊，让历史和现在以及未来的这种连结啊，通过视觉化的表达，通过这种色彩的表达，文字的这个表达等等，这就是提刚才的这个 VIVE 的案例，就给到了我们一个非常有意义的一个启示。好，那么接下来呢，我们有请的是 Aldo Civic 啊，他是意大利建筑设计师 Civic Workshop 的创始人，那么致力于在建筑室内以及设计方面开发区 具有多样性和可持续性的这个方案。它项目呢也曾经在威尼斯建筑双年展上展出，设计的作品和图纸在阿姆斯特丹市立博物馆、巴黎的蓬皮杜艺术中心等等博物馆呢做了永久的收藏。他也是上海同济大学的荣誉教授，上海社科院城市研究的荣誉教授。我们有请 Aldo Sibic。 Mr. Aldo Sibic, welcome to share the insight from
Hello,
from your
everybody.
Hand.
Thank you, David, for a kind invitation. To introduce briefly myself, I'm Aldo Sibic, architect and designer from Milano, honorary professor, and I'm teaching also at Tongji University in Shanghai, one of the founders of the Memphis design movement, and curator of Venice Pavilion at Biennale of 2015. This year, I'm also being Italian design ambassador in Shanghai for the Italian Design Day. And since 5 years, I live in Shanghai, which is a city that I love more and more. This topic is very sensitive for us, in the sense that in the last year, we had the opportunity to realize two exhibitions at MAP, the Museum of Art Pudong, promoted and organized by the Shanghai Italian Institute of Culture. It's a beautiful museum designed by Jean Nouvel, the French architect, and the museum is now the number one on the ranking of Chinese museums. Design for Fun is the title of the first exhibition we have done, and the topic was 70 years of Italian radical design. In this case, we have created a very playful environment documenting the incredible variety of avant-garde design that Italy has produced since the 60s. Regarding the other exhibition I mentioned, the title is A World of Beauty. It's the one I love the most in my life. It was showing 70 masterpieces from Pompeii, from the Farnese collection of the National Archaeological Museum of Naples. It was the first time that these pieces that left Italy. The challenge has been to design an environment and to tell a story which could deeply engage the Chinese public. What we have done has been to produce a sense of beauty through an emotional experience given by an harmonious combination of different rooms with colors, with darkness, with very inspiring quotes. I mean, the people, for example, they were just taking pictures of the quotes to involve them more in the issue. And so, I mean, for the visitor, it was a very comprehensible and was also a moving way to show these pieces. In the process of the making of the exhibition, there is a moment that I think I'll never forget. It's when, one afternoon, in a video call between Madame Li, the director of the MAP Shanghai Museum, and Paolo Giuliarini, the director of the Archaeological Museum of Naples, while they were speaking to each other, the feeling was a special, deep, and sincere reciprocal respect. In a way, it's like for the first time I realized how culture is able to generate a deep and sincere reciprocal respect between people apparently so distant. So it was really, I mean, the motion of understanding that we have to do as much as we can to increase the cultural exchange in order to overcome all the difficulties that we have in understanding each other. So culture is the strongest bridge we can build. In this case, it was between China and Italy. But I think for this complicated future is the biggest hope for all of us.
非常感谢 Aldo Civic 啊啊！我刚才讲这个，我本人作为一个艺术爱好者，确实也是在疫情刚刚结束的时候也是去看过 MAP 啊，就是浦东美术馆的刚才 Civic 先生所提到的两个来自于意大利的展览，这个有。这有这个历史的一面，也有现代性的这个一面。他也提到了这种发自内心的文化之间的这种互相的尊重，这是非常重要的一个超越艺术之外的一个文化文明的一个底蕴。那由于时间的关系呢，确实每一位我们的演讲者都有非常丰富的这个经历。但是由于时间关系，每位嘉宾都只有八分钟的时间来进行表达，所以请允许我快速的就这一场的这个内容做一个简短的这个总结。我们刚才几位嘉宾都已经谈到了，从博物馆的这个领导者来看，我们如何把历史与现代来做一个结合，如何把艺术与现代做一个结合。那么更为关键的是，我们也谈到了我们的如何把年轻的一代作为未来的这个博物馆的重要的参观者、艺术的欣赏者啊，乃至于通过科技的力量来进行艺术的共创，这些呢都是一些重要的这个话题啊，值得我们未来啊在这样的一个整体的框架下呢，我们进一步的做这个充分的这种。案例的研讨和这个更为深层次的包括跨界啊，包括我们的在来自于艺术方技术方面的这些人员专家给到我们一些新的这个启示啊。那我想本次的这个论坛的环节就到这里结束了，我再次把这个时间和这个空间交还给David Gosse 高大伟先生。高大伟先生有请。
Thank you very much, Professor, for your wonderful chairmanship. And I was very moved when I was listening to the five presentations. And clearly, I am sure that in the conclusion, Professor Louis Godard will talk more about that, but in a divided world, beauty is a very important unifying element. And art, it has been said yesterday, true art is always about elevation. So thank you very much, Professor from EM Lyon. We come back to Nankai University. And as I was telling you yesterday, at Nankai University, the Faculty of History is very important. A lot of important work has been done in this faculty on the Chinese history and world history. Therefore, it's a great pleasure for me to give the floor now to Professor Yuanshan Wen, Associate Dean of the Faculty of History of Nankai University, and Professor Yuanshan Wen will guide us, will moderate the last session of our meeting. Professor Yuanshan Wen, Yuan 教授，请你来主持这个环节，谢谢。
好的，谢谢尊敬的高大伟先生，尊敬的各位与会嘉宾，下午好。很高兴，中欧美博物馆倡议第三场对话在南开大学举行，也很感谢高大伟先生和会议主办方对我的信任，让我来担任本次对话分论坛三的主持人。本论坛的主题呢是博物馆如何通过对艺术和文化的保护来提高大众对人类共同未来的认识。这也是我们深入探讨博物馆使命的一个重要话题。下面呢，将五位来自中外的专家学者围绕这个论题 发表精彩的这个演讲。首先我们欢迎泰斯戴维德博士，戴维斯博士。戴维斯博士呢是律师和考古学家。他曾以优异的成绩毕业于波士顿大学考古专业，后来在佐治亚大学获得了法学博士学位。现任文物保护联盟委员会执行董事，主要负责监管打击文物及走私相关工作，同时掌管机构华盛顿员工和海外项目的日常运营。他对柬埔寨和美国政府两国之间艺术界和这个文物保护抵制掠夺文物进入市场做出了重要贡献，也受到了泰国柬埔寨王国政府的授予的爵位和勋章。下面我们欢迎戴维斯博士。
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to join so many governments, organizations, colleagues, and friends around the world in this international conference on museums as cultural intermediaries in the dialogue between civilizations. Again, my name is Tess Davis, and I'm Executive Director of the Antiquities Coalition. As an organization dedicated to stopping the black market in cultural heritage while increasing responsible cultural exchange,We're honored to join this important event, and we commend the China-Europe-America Museums Cooperation Initiative for again putting this issue on your agenda in 2023. As the program for today notes, museums are essential to the protection of cultural heritage, which in turn does much to contribute to the global community. 2023 is a fitting time to discuss how cultural heritage contributes to the global community,because this year marks the 20th anniversary of the looting of the National Museum of Iraq, as well as the widespread pillage at archaeological sites across the country by everyone from opportunistic criminals to terrorist groups like Al-Qaeda. This is by no means the first example of cultural theft and destruction during wartime, but due to a combination of factors, including the sheer scale of the thefts, that the losses included touchstones from the cradle of Western civilization,and that they were beamed into the public's living room on a 24-hour news cycle. The looting of the Iraq Museum changed the global conversation on the illicit antiquities trade and broader threats to cultural heritage. This tragedy raised awareness in the culture and the arts, the general public, and policymakers, galvanizing the international community, which directly and indirectly led to concrete changes in law and policy around the world.The anniversary is thus an opportunity to take stock of what has changed in the last two decades. And there has been a visible shift in the way the international community treats crimes against cultural heritage, even if much remains to be done. First, there is a growing awareness that theft from museums and the broader illicit antiquities trade is a serious crime. This may seem obvious to all of us, especially today on International Museum Day, but it was not always the case.The 1970 UNESCO Convention had helped to establish this idea that looting and trafficking of archaeological sites was not just unethical, but illicit. And before the looting of the Iraq Museum, the treaty was already gaining an acceptance. But following this tragedy, the UN Security Council did much to further the conversation with a series of binding and unanimous resolutions. These were hugely important.This is because the Security Council is the only UN body with the power to compel member states. It can establish peacekeeping operations, impose binding sanctions, and authorize military action. And yet it has a very narrow mandate. Its main job is responding to threats to international peace and security. So by putting this issue on its agenda at all, the Security Council was making a powerful statement. Cultural theft and destruction can be a threat to international peace and security.We've now seen many intergovernmental bodies follow the Security Council's lead. But this process started after the Iraq Museum, it sharply accelerated after the Arab Spring and Egyptian Revolution, and especially after the rise of Daesh in Iraq and Syria. The international community has now recognized time and again that crimes against culture threaten human rights, national economies, and even global security.Second, since the 2003 looting of the Iraq Museum, there's also been a growing awareness that protecting cultural heritage requires a cross-sectoral approach. This is not a burden that archaeologists or conservators or restorers or even museums should bear alone. We need government, law enforcement, the military, the private sector, and experts and institutions from the arts and culture at the table. Everyone has a role to play. And building on this, third, crimes against culture cannot be solved by any one country. They require a global response. We see this too from the 2003 looting of the Iraq Museum. Stolen pieces were recovered not just in Iraq, but in multiple countries around the world, the United States, Switzerland, Japan, even on eBay. Over the last two decades, the international community has shown much willingness to tackle this problem through a number of international fora, and this global engagement reflects unprecedented momentum. But nonetheless, lack of political will still remains the main obstacle to positive change. There is a great need to convene world leaders of countries, intergovernmental organizations, indigenous peoples, and faiths to raise awareness and grow support for coordinated action. It is especially important to continue moving the discussion beyond cultural officials and ministries and recognizing that cultural crimes are not just a threat to our shared history, but again, to human rights, national economies, and global security. There is still much that can and should be done, but I think it's important to acknowledge how far we've come over the last 20 years and to think initiatives like the China Europe America Initiative and the many others speaking today for their role in realizing this progress. It's only through these conversations that we can begin to ensure our past is preserved for the next generation. Thank you.
Oh, 谢谢戴维斯博士。 戴维斯博士呢, 从, 国际合作的交流的, 这个, 角度, 通过梳理, 伊拉克国家博物馆文物被盗事件, 然后, 为我们分析了国际间, 从联合国到国际社会之间的对于文物犯罪的共同认识, 以及需要各部门之间的联合合作, 还有就是需要国际间的这种合作交流, 共同来推动, 我们人类共同文化遗产的这个保护。 好, 感谢戴维斯博士。 我们有请, 下一位是, 南开大学, 博物馆的副馆长, 张继文博士。 张继文博士呢, 他是南开大学博物馆的副馆长, 是南开大学文物考古实验中心的副主任。 他是, 文博考古研究中心的副主任, 就是有两个这样的职务。 他在, 文物的, 文创, 以及理论研究上有颇高的建树。 下面我们来欢迎张继文博士。
感谢主持人的介绍，大家好，我是南开大学博物馆的张静文。很高兴今天有机会跟大家来共同探讨一个话题，博物馆应该如何利用数字技术来驱动文化遗产的集体传承。那么我们都知道，博物馆作为公共文化服务机构，肩负着保护和保存文化遗产，并且向后代传承的责任。 那么其中的核心任务之一就是将文化遗产更广泛的价值阐释出来、传承下去。通过对文化遗产价值的建构、阐释和共享，博物馆可以增进公众对文化遗产的理解，使遗产和当代社会的关系更加紧密，从而使遗产的文化信息和它的物质载体都能够拥有持续不断的 传承至未来的能力。但我们也逐渐认识到，单纯依靠现在博物馆有限的实体空间和文化遗产本体，能够传递给公众的文化信息是非常有限的。况且从公众需求的层面看，当前世界各地的博物馆都正在面临着越来越多元的公众需求，比如注重体验、 注重个体感受和主体性表达。那么年轻一代的博物馆公众则更是面临着个性化需求高、交互意愿增强等一些独特的特点。他们对于信息传播渠道的可交互性 信息内容的专业性和创意性，以及观赏体验的沉浸感和精密度等等，都有着越来越高的需求。相信针对满足博物馆公众多元需求这一议题，世界各国的博物馆界学者都在进行着不懈的探索和努力，从各个方面，从各个领域，其中日新月异的数字技术为我们提高观众体验，焕发文化遗产的持续生命力提供了有力的手段。在数字技术营造的新时空中，博物馆可以以新的形式、新的结构和新的表征来表达和传播文化遗产价值，使他们获得新的延续和生长。同时，数字技术也会为文化遗产和博物馆藏品的民主化提供更多的机会和更多的可能性。那么从上世纪80年代以来，世界各国就逐渐开始开展了一些面向文化遗产记忆和传承的数字化项目，比如美国数字记忆、欧洲时光机、芬兰的国家集体记忆平台等等。那么中国的博物馆界近年来也在这方面做出了卓越的成就，尤其以故宫博物院、敦煌博物院、南京博物院、上海博物馆等为代表的一些博物馆，他们借助云计算、物联网、大数据、人工智能等一些新技术，为观众提供了场馆导航、文物解读、交互体验以及教育、直播等各类服务，起到了很好的示范效益。但总体而言，由于当前技术、人才、资金等方方面面的问题，当前大多数的博物馆仍然面临着许多的困难和问题，比如资源利用率低、公众参与不足等等一些短板。虽然我们遗产保护的理念已经从对物的本体保存发展到对人价值和精神的深度阐释和利用，但至少是目前在文化遗产数字化领域仍然普遍呈现出强价值认同和弱现状感知双向背离的矛盾，也就是文化遗产机构和公众对于文化遗产数字化的价值认同度比较高，但是呢，对文化遗产数字化的发展程度评价却相对较低。我们的文化遗产机构虽然已经拥有了海量的数据资源，但是呢，其中有相当一部分的数据资源仍然处在沉睡数据和数据孤岛的状态，急需我们发挥智慧、发挥力量，利用新的技术，将这些文化遗产基础数据转化为可以深度利用的文化生产要素，从而释放出它们的多元价值。那么当然要实现这一点，我们还有很长的路要走。那我认为其中有两点是特别需要注意的，也是南开大学的博物馆学专业正在做的事情。一方面，我们致力于在新技术的辅助下，推动文化遗产数字化从低精密度、低挖掘度的弱科技供给，走向高精密度、高呈现力的强科技供给。比如我们可以利用大数据和人工智能等技术去解释文化遗产数字资源中蕴含的文化基因、语义内涵、知识关联和本体价值，构建可解释、可信赖、可溯源、可推理的文化遗产智慧数据。那么在这样一个基础上，再去借助虚拟现实、增强现实、可视化等一系列的技术手段，去搭建以传承文化遗产价值为导向的展示系统和教育平台，从而以更广阔的视野和更包容的姿态，将文化遗产的研究成果进行多角度的关联、阐释和共享。 那么另一方面，我们也在尝试进行更多的跨学科合作和对话，以及利用信息众包等方式吸引和鼓励更广泛的公众参与到文化遗产信息的收集、加工和呈现过程中，作为潜在的知识生产群体，将以往单向的知识灌输转为双向的知识交流，利用现代化的社会化的知识转化模式，使那些通常被忽视的声音和更多的历史视角得以共存，使博物馆数字化平台成为公众讨论热点议题、进行创新性表达和个性化阐释的开放空间。由博物馆作为磁铁和纽带来吸引和关联公众记忆，促使文化遗产信息升华为具有地方性、区域性的集体记忆，以唤起公众对文化归属的自我确认和对文化传承的责任担当，为人类发展提供连续不断的精神力量。那么 以上就是我希望与大家分享的全部内容，谢谢大家。
好，谢谢张建文博士。张博士呢，从数字技术对这个博物馆文化遗产信息传播中的作用，以及在这个中外博物馆在在文物遗产的文化遗产的数字化方面的这个成就以及存在问题进行了深入剖析，并以这个南开大学博物馆针对以上存在的问题所做的探索来说明我们在文化遗产保护数字化上面工作的未来的指向，那么为今后博物馆在未来发展中的作用啊进行了展望。再次感谢张建文博士。下面呢，我们请超毅理想文化学会的荣誉会长陈福生女士发言啊。陈福生女士呢，她主要从事国际公益文化活动及担任影视制作人，是经常举办了也是专栏作家，经常举办大型的文化艺术活动，在北京担任了多项的社会公职。我们欢迎陈博士女士。
大家好，我是陈富生，很高兴代表超毅理想文化学会参与今天的活动。我第一次到南开是2014年的五月。那时候我们拍摄纪念周恩来总理的纪录片《感恩东来爱湘江》。周总理曾经在南开上学，所以我们特别跑到南开拍摄他从前上学的地方，表演话剧的礼堂，他少年时期写的诗的作品等等。这许多珍贵的历史文物，南开都保存得非常好。后来在2019年五月份，我们又跟南开大学一起举办了一场纪念周恩来总理的音乐会，同时纪念五四运动100周年和南开大学建校100周年。南开是中国一所历史悠久的大学，我们的开国总理周恩来是南开的杰出校友，他是一位伟大的政治家、外交家，深受世人尊敬。他儒雅谦和的风范，相信跟他从小在南开培养他热爱文化艺术的兴趣有关。所以今天我们在这充满人文气息的南开大学举办活动是特别有意义的。 I'm aware that this is the third dialogue and I know that many more will follow. I'm happy to see that this year the University of Nankai is deeply involved. Today I would like to convey one key messageYou may know Hong Kong for its tradition of entertainment. Canton pop is still influential. Actually, since the early 1970s, the Canton pop of Hong Kong has been influencing Chinese people around the world. Many Chinese living abroad and in the Guangdong province in southern China particularly those of us who were born and raised in Hong Kong, are familiar with using Cantonese. As a result, I will be delivering my speech in Cantonese. 大家所熟悉的香港是全球领先的国际金融中心之一。而近年香港亦都同时锐意发展成为中外文化艺术交流中心。2022年全球艺术市场的价值大约是680亿美元。而香港现在是仅次于纽约的全球第二大艺术市场。疫情受控之后，今年三月香港正式通关。我们就即刻恢复成功举办了巴塞尔艺术展，巩固了香港作为全球艺术中心的地位。而历年来国际知名的拍卖行，好像佳士得、苏富比和富艺斯等等，他们在香港的竞争就正正反映出这个市场的重要性。讲到文化艺术的保护，就一定要提及我们的西九龙文化区了。这个坐落在维港海旁的西九龙文化区是全球规模最大的文化项目之一，集艺术、教育和公共空间于一身，凸显香港作为中外文化交流桥梁的重要角色。区内有两间新近落成的博物馆，一间是香港故宫文化博物馆，以崭新的角度、独特的策展手法、新颖的表现形式，结合环球视野，跨越时空，展示故宫的珍贵文物，传承中国传统文化。另一间 M 家博物馆是亚洲首间全球性当代视觉文化博物馆，馆里面的收藏品涵盖了20和21世纪的视觉艺术、设计和建筑、流动影像以及香港视觉文化，以香港中西荟萃的历史特色为基础，结合科技、光影等视觉效果，为我们带来难忘的沉浸式跨媒体艺术体验。还有值得一提的，就是我们现在积极发展的粤港澳大湾区，实行一国两制的香港也是其中一份子。2020年大湾区的总人口已经超过8600万，地区生产总值超过16000亿美元。大湾区是包括了香港、澳门两个特别行政区，以及广东省的广州、深圳、珠海、佛山、惠州、东莞、中山、江门和肇庆九个城市。当地人除了喜欢讲粤语，亦都传承了独特的岭南文化色彩。岭南文化是中国传统文化的重要组成。我深信大湾区的文化领域，再结合我们香港的法制、普通法、简单的税制、金融、保险、物流、航运等等完善的设施，将会为大家带来惊喜。文化和艺术是人类创造的精神财富，记录和传达了人类的历史、信仰、思想和价值观，是人类文明的重要结晶。博物馆承载着人类的文化遗产，令到我们了解过去，带来反思和觉悟，同时亦都感恩前人的遗泽，让我们更加珍惜现在，展望未来。我非常感谢高大伟先生创立中欧美博物馆合作倡议，促进世界文明对话和合作，共享精神财富。我们超艺理想文化学会一向都致力于推动国际文化交流，博物馆将大家团结一起，希望通过务实的合作，加深人与人之间相互了解，增进国与国之间的友谊，维护世界和平，并且为人类带来繁荣与稳定。多谢各位。
Professor Yuan Shenwen just had a technical problem, so we will try to solve it as soon as possible. Professor Yuan was expressing his gratitude to Cathy Chan, the chairwoman of Art Concept Culture, and he was saying that indeed now in the field of art museums, Hong Kong is playing a key role. Now we will proceed, we will continue the conversation. And after Hong Kong, we have the great pleasure to go back to Europe, to go to Venice, a wonderful place, and a place which I have to say means a lot to me, the Giorgio Cini Foundation on the beautiful island of San Giorgio, and Madame Renato Codello. It's really a great pleasure for us to have you with us. I know you are so busy at the foundation and now so busy with the Biennale, but it's a great honor that you are offering to us by your presence. Madame Renata Codello, the floor is yours. Grazie mille. And the good news, sorry, madam, is that Professor Yuan is back. So I will give the floor back to him after your address. Thank you. Grazie.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Gosset.
Please, madam, you can address the meeting.
So, like you see, the Fondazione Giorgio Cini is located in an island, San Giorgio Maggiore in Venice, overlooking one of the world's most famous piazza, San Marco Square. As a no-profit cultural foundation, since 1951, it has been responsible for preserving, studying, and making accessible the extremely rich cultural heritage to be found in its spaces, one which testifies to both Italian and world history, creativity, and the arts. But besides that, one of the key aims of the Fondazione Cini is to enrich this heritage by connecting it with the outside world, with other collections, libraries, educational institution, and people. One of the most recent major projects of the Fondazione Cini is the Archive Center, analysis and recording of cultural heritage in Venice, which saw the light in 2018 in the wake of its partnership with the Factum Foundation for Digital Technology in Preservation and the Digital Humanities Laboratory of the École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne, with the support of the Ellen Hamlin Trust, an English trust. The main aim of the Archive Center is to achieve the cultural aims of the Fondazione Cini and its partnership through the use of new digital technologies applied to cultural heritage. To do this, the Archive Center focuses on the educational, digitalization, and source dissemination projects to generate new knowledge in a broad, radical manner open to all. A brilliant example of this is the work carried out in the archive of Tiziano Terzani, a journalist, writer who traveled the world from the 1960s onwards to report on major contemporary historical and political events. He lived for about 30 years in various states in Asia as a foreign correspondent for Der Spiegel and other magazines, focusing his activity mainly in China and frequently exploring South Asia, Southeast Asia, India, Russia. Always on the front lines reporting on transformations, wars and revolutions, he took thousands of photographs, documents, diaries, and so on. His archive, housed in the Fondazione Cini, today bears tangible witness to his travels, his in-depth reflections on awards in a constant state of change. The Archive Centers has digitized part of the archive, especially his photographs. The conservation goals of digitalization go hand in hand with the belief that these documents and images should be shared with the whole world to show places, people and civilization at an epoch-making moment in history. Sharing these sources online makes it possible to research faraway places from Venice to China, Vietnam, India, Myanmar, and Japan. The desire is to unit the knowledge of historians and archivists with the knowledge of those who study and live in the places Terzani narrated and captured in his shots. The Archive Center is committed to ensuring that the sources already cataloged and made available online on the Cini Foundation website are increasingly accessible thanks to the cutting-edge digital tools that allow them to be consulted and exchanged, as well as for information to be entered with a view to generating new knowledge. In this sense, and thanks to the contact commitment of those who work every day in museums, libraries, archives, and foundations, those who carry out research and those who adopt new methods and technologies to shorten distances, that cultural institutions such as the Fondazione Giorgio Cini represent fundamental intermediaries in the dialogue between different culture and civilization. This is more important for our mission. Thank you.
I am sorry, our dear Professor Yuan still has some technical problems, that he is frozen, as you might see, and we cannot hear him, but he just thanked Madame Renato Codello, and he appreciates and understands very much the fact that your institution, your prestigious foundation, acts as a bridge between cultures in a city which is already a bridge between cultures. So this is clearly a very important work that you are doing at the Giorgio Cini Foundation. And we are all very much interested by the use of technology, the use of technology, indeed digitalization, to do better what you were already doing in the past, collecting the role of the archives and exhibiting better, protecting cultural heritage in general. So on behalf of all of those involved in this forum, on behalf also of our friends in Nankai, I would like to thank you, Madame, for your support. And I hope that in the future, we will continue the conversation.
我会问我的同事，现在就是这个主信的问题解决了吗？我们可以回到那个袁教授。好，so the technical problem has been solved, so I give the floor to Professor Yuan. 抱歉 ，sorry for that。
好的，谢谢高大伟先生。下面我们请艺术家胡谦。 先生给我们做精彩发言。吴谦先生呢，毕业于纽约大学社会与文化分析学院，在2021到2022年，在中国国家画院担任访问学者，曾经在纽约、威尼斯、上海和深圳举办个展。欢迎吴谦先生。
Hello everyone, I am Chen Wu, a Chinese artist. It is a real pleasure to have been invited here to represent the international artists who are participating in the China-Europe-American Museum Cooperation Initiative Forum. We are grateful to participate in this event and gain insights into the present while exploring our path to the future. I have been fortunate to develop close connections with China, Europe, and the US. The art market and its mechanisms have been continuously improving and expanding in these three regions for centuries. Galleries, auction houses, museums, collectors, critics, curators, and so on make up a functioning art system. When contemporary artists' artworks go into a museum, they also become part of a museum's ecosystem. From another perspective, the emergence of artists and art trends is inseparable from the support and the development of museums and art galleries. Apart from art creation, artists need to be recognized by academic institutions. In this sense, museums have an inherently important function, that is to cultivate and inspire artists' creativity. In fact, one of the purposes of many art museums is to provide exhibition opportunities for artists and to collect their works. Therefore, to ensure stability of cultural traditions, museums play an important role in stimulating artistic innovation. When I studied in Chicago and New York, I realized that art galleries and museums, there were not just galleries and the museums, but also schools and classrooms. In recent years, cultural exchanges between China and the European countries have become increasingly frequent. For example, the tightening bond between China and Italy is especially noticeable. I just participated in the awards ceremony of the 17th Art Laguna Prize in Venice, Italy. I was successfully shortlisted and won the Emerging Artist Award. I am the first Chinese artist ever and the only award winner in the painting category. Invited by the organizer, the Cultural Association MOCA, I held my first solo exhibition, Blue Qian Wu Solo Exhibition in Europe, at the Cultural Association MOCA Venice. Currently, I live and work in Xiamen, China, a beautiful seaside city attracting many tourists with its beautiful scenery and rich cultural heritage. Recently, Xiamen Airlines invited me to present a Blue Siri art-themed cabin named Blues in the Sky, which will exhibit in the Xiamen Airlines gallery for 1 month. This is a new attempt of Art Xiamen Airlines and the first artist-themed cabin of Xiamen Airlines. It showcased an extension and expansion of the art exhibition space. As a signature of Xiamen, the Gulangsu, an historical international settlement island, is an important carrier of exchanges and mutual learning among different cultures. In January this year, the San Marino Shaman World Heritage Photo Exhibition I co-curated was held at the Gulangsu Gallery of Foreign Artifacts from the Palace Museum's collection, clearly showing the rich cultural heritage of the two places to audience at home and abroad. San Marino National Television reported it with the title A Photo Exhibition in Xiamen Highlighting the Civilization of China and San Marino as a gift of the 50th anniversary of China-San Marino diplomatic relations establishment. From September 1st to October 1st this year, there will be the San Marino Republic Day and the President's Autumn Inauguration. San Marino Shaman World Heritage Photo Exhibition will tour the capital of San Marino. Invited by the Ministry of Culture and the Government of San Marino, I will give a speech at a large forum themed Art Bridging People's Hearts, hosted by San Marino, to encourage dialogue on the friendship and the philosophy behind this exhibition. As an artist and a curator, for me, civilizations are not isolated, but endlessly seeking out each other. Today's initiative deepens the cooperation and understanding among international museums and promotes extensive across-culture partnership in arts. The influence of Chinese, European, and American cultures on contemporary arts never fades, and the fusion and enlightenment they bring will be revisited in the context of globalization. I am very much looking forward to more communication and cooperation among international museums in the future. Finally, I wish the China-Europe-American Museum Cooperation Initiative a great success. Thank you.
谢谢吴谦先生，吴谦先生呢以自己的亲身作为一个艺术家的亲身经历，给我们分享了艺术家和博物馆之间的紧密联系，并通过自己的这个策展实践，阐述了艺术家在和博物馆在文化交流之间的重要纽带作用。下面呢，我们再次感谢吴谦先生。鉴于这个时间原因，我就简单的把本组的五位嘉宾的发言做一个简单的总结。五位专家呢，从不同的角度对博物馆在艺术和文化保护中所起的这个作用，尤其是从联合的国际间部门间的联合的工作，包括从法律政策角度以及一些具体实践来推动国际间的文化合作。包括在技术手段上，从数字化在文化遗产保护中的作用，以及实践对我们博物馆的，在这个文化艺术保护中的作用和未来的发展趋势，做了精彩的这个发言。最后还是热烈感谢以上五位专家的精彩发言。好，下面我还把时间交给高大伟先生，谢谢您，有请。
Thank you very much, Professor Yuanshan Wen, for your support and your chairmanship today. And of course, we had some tech problems, but we solved them. So we are very happy now. It's the time already to go to the closing ceremony. We have had two very productive days. the closing ceremony, we design it in a way that it can also open new intellectual perspectives. I think it's a very diverse group of people, and of course we will have the great honor to listen to Professor Louis Godard and to Professor Yu Xinzhong for their final views on our activities. But it gives me really great pleasure to leave China for a while, leave Spain, Venice, and to go back to the United States of America. Madame Joanne McKenty, former Vice Secretary of the US Department of Commerce, has been very supportive, always from the very beginning when we established the China, Europe, America Global Initiative, also very supportive on our conversation on museums. And it gives me great pleasure to give her the floor. Joanne McKenty, the floor is yours.
Hello. We have learned a tremendous amount about the value of museums and culture today. As we reflect on this wonderful exchange of ideas, I want to address two questions. First, how critical are museums to international collaboration? Second, how essential are museums for people's personal growth? Professor Joseph Nye coined the term soft power, declaring it is what attracts others to be willing to do what should be done. By using soft power as caretakers of all forms of culture, museums have the ability to be powerful agents of change, applying their unique and comparative advantage to address critical global challenges facing today's world. For example, the establishment of satellite museums in foreign cities enables people in those places to experience artistic creativity as well as lifestyles from their international counterparts without having to travel. The results of such satellite programs also has had enormous influences in achieving increased international exposure and understanding throughout the globe. For example, the New York Guggenheim Museum satellite program helped to turn a small Spanish city called Bilbao in northern Spain into a coveted cultural destination. This addition to that city helped reinvigorate the city's stalled economy by attracting significant tourism. And the satellite program also has served as a model for other cities such as Denver and Abu Dhabi. These results demonstrate the soft power of museums to serve as international diplomats, not just as repositories of culture and art, but achieving substantial recognition as contributors to the societies and economies in which they are operating. The 2017 Michelangelo and recent Vermeer blockbuster exhibits involved international cooperation of over 8 countries engaging in museum global relationship building using this positive soft power. Museums have demonstrated their diplomatic capabilities by achieving acceptance from international organizations such as UNESCO and the G20, acknowledging the role that the museum community plays along with those of cities, states, and countries in efforts to conquer and control illegal artistic looting, as well as influencing critical climate control issues. Just as many have embraced the benefits that technology can play in expenditures, expanding the value of museums, especially to younger generations, if applied judiciously, museum soft power growth indeed is not an aberration, but rather something to be embraced. So now we ask the second question. How is it that museums, as the keepers of art and treasures of the past and the future, can have such positive influence on human behavior? What is the underlying influencer that promotes museums to engage their soft power using their culture, art, and antiquities to achieve positive results for people daily? Museums can increase our sense of well-being, help us feel proud of where we have come, can inspire, challenge, and stimulate us and make us feel healthier. They also enhance life chances by breaking down barriers to access and inclusion. As we have learned, the work of creating strong communities is continuing to happen at all levels of society in every corner of the world. It continues in indigenous cultures. It is permeating homeschools, workplaces, neighborhoods, anywhere and everywhere we come together. The internet and social media have engaged as our global virtual campfire and have the capacity to foster and support healthy community growth if harnessed in the right way. The journal Nature determined in an issue on the science of human cooperation that the strongest barrier to people's getting along is simply a lack of communication. With definitive scientific support, today many of us are discovering that creative expressions, culture, and the arts are paramount to the effective exchange of ideas and to our very survival. Creative expressions in the arts and aesthetics, which are a core of what museums are, serve to give birth to new thoughts and new ideas as they mirror back to one another what is important and what is needed to weave together common threads of humanity. Culture presented within museums empowers us to reimagine, re-envision, and reconnect in order to create a better future together. Museums are the caretakers of the world's arts and heritage, which throughout history have sparked revolution and cultural change. By their very nature, many of these forms of art reflect and form a timeline as they take the pulse of that very time. But they also have been known to be essential for forecasting the future and serving as an early warning system for society. The Greek chorus became the moral voice of civilization. The Renaissance propelled humanity out of the Middle Ages using music and storytelling, and the artists of 1980s Germany turned the Berlin Wall into a showcase of artistic piece graffiti. Creative applications of artistic innovation are transforming museums into becoming sensory samples of positive human experiences. Such undertakings are designed to encourage greater tolerance of personal, cultural, and hopefully political global differences. The New York Museums of Art opened an interactive sensory stimulating exhibition called the Mandala Lab as a permanent place for visitors to enjoy a space that was curated, using Buddhist principles, supporting self-awareness and empathy. In this secret room, you are invited to inhale selections from a library of different smells. A meditative breathing alcove features a sculpture that pulses with light on pace with regulated breathing. In the gong space, you can tap out to one of the 8 gong Jamaican vibrations. Arts have the ability to transform us like nothing else, as they can help move us from sickness to health, stress to calm, sadness to joy, as they enable people to flourish and survive. The arts always offer the highest form of hope, and science is now providing new knowledge, supporting their use as the core of museums around the world. Humans are ultra-social creatures who have evolved to require a need to belong to something larger than oneself. You see a gorgeous clay pot of Lucca, Italy, and you think of how it resembles one of the Xi'an statues of China. A Chinese calligraphy horse drawing immediately makes you think of the flourishing strokes of a Michelangelo. Art creates culture, and culture creates community, and community creates need for cooperation across global borders in order to flourish. As a well-known artist said, art is one of our true global languages, and it helps the need to reveal, heal, and transform. It transcends our ordinary lives and lets us imagine what is possible. Museums continue to explore all forms of art and artistic expression. They teach us, they challenge us, they comfort us, and they expose us to differences which lead to better global tolerance and understanding. And yes, this is why we need museums today more than ever. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joanne, for your very inspiring words, as always. And we hope that you continue from Washington, D.C. To support us, and more importantly, to contribute to the harmonization of the relations between China and the United States of America. We will listen to Professor Godard, who has been with us during the 2 days already. But before we give the floor to Professor Louis Godard in Rome, I would like to introduce a young student. She comes from the beautiful city of Hangzhou. I am sure that most of you have been by the West Lake. It's really a beautiful place. And thanks to the support of Professor Louis Godard, of Joanne McEntee, of friends in Beijing, Mr. Yu Yunquan, actually, we have launched what we call China, Europe, America International Communication Challenge. We have had the challenge already for 2 years. And this year, Ms. Hu Dingyi, a young student from Zhejiang University, has won the challenge. And since she happens to be a student in museology, well, we said, why don't you come to Nankai to see Tianjin, but also to address our international event? And Ms. Hu Dingyi accepted. That is the story. And now I spoke too much. I will give the floor to Ms. Hu Dingyi. Ms. Hu, you are welcome. And you are a friend here and you are at home here. So be very happy.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and also good morning. And I'm very honored to be here in this beautiful city, Tianjin, and also the beautiful university, Nankai. And I've learned a lot from all of you and your brilliant speeches today. So I'm a beginner and also a learner. I'm going to share my own stories with museum today. Every time someone asks me about something like the impression on the cities or places I've traveled to, I always enthusiastically start talking about the museums here. As a kid, I loved to travel. I was captivated by the exquisite relics of the Palace Museum in Beijing, and I visited Nanjing 3 times, just wanted to take a look at Nanjing Museum. On my trip to Shanghai, I fell in love with the beautiful and diversity of its inclusiveness museum. To me, the best way to understand the distant and a familiar cultural city is to get close to its museums. Time and time again, in front of the display cabinet, I've heard the mute exchanges between cultures and the histories. The conversations were taking place among paintings, porcelains, sculptures, and bronze from different civilizations and eras. The pottery from late Neolithic China and Greece are surprisingly similar, while the wall painting in the same cave of Dunhuang have different styles. Exploring the museum, just like walking along the river of civilization, I traveled thousands of miles and I traveled thousands of years. Years later, I'm blessed to major in cultural heritage and museum studies. I get much more chances to listen to the dialogues between civilizations and the museum, understanding our own culture and others. In class, I learned about the Chinese jade culture, but it was only after I had seen an ancient Chinese and a Mexican jade civilization exhibition that I realized the existence of entirely different jade culture from us. Interestingly, Mexicans put a green jade bead in the mouth of the dead, and Chinese in Han Dynasty put jade cicada, all with the hope of eternal life. So how amazing these two distinct cultures sharing the same love and bliss for jade. And I also learned about Chinese brownware from books. But what delighted me the most was witnessing the ancient Roman brownware from Italy. Among them, the brownware of Victor Wing had caught my attention. The wing is full of confidence and courage, and showing me the extrinsic power of ancient Roman civilization. While Chinese ancient bronze are almost ritual vessels, and they stand for solemnity and order. So in comparison, I could also see a more vivid picture of Chinese bronze wares. In many years to come, I'm lucky enough to become a curator and in a museum, building a bridge of dialogue between civilizations with my effort. There are so many things I need to carefully contemplate and consider. If we want to make conversation, we have to make connection. I want to make connection between individuals
Learning
and
in progress.
I want to tell vivid and specific stories that can provoke everyone to think about themselves and try to understand other cultures. For example, if I were to tell the story of the terracotta warriors, I would rather ask the audience first about their thoughts on the concept of eternity. From the individual perspective of life or death, we can better see what the terracotta warriors truly represent and what we all human beings are longing for. And I also want to make connection of big civilization through the encounter of little cultural relics. Just as the occult artifacts of Forbidden City are on display at the Louvre, and making two imperial palaces have an intimate dialogue. At the same time, we generation are confident that more bridges will be built over the ocean of the internet. Breaking down geographic barriers and sharing the achievements of civilizations across time and space. Even in the face of the pandemic in recent years, I can still explore museums from different countries and regions online. Forbidden Palace Museum, Dunhuang Museum, British Museum, Metropolitan Museum, and I've seen and condensed world civilization. And we are really, really lucky enough to be a generation who can witness such conversations whenever we want and whatever we like. And these conversations have accompanied me in my growth. In these 70 hour conversations, we can hear different voices and harmonious. And I think this is a beautiful melody that can be heard as a youngster and a young curator. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madame, for your wonderful speech, inspiring speech. And I am sure very soon, very, very soon, you will be able to design, imagine, and curate wonderful exhibitions, connecting people, serving at the end of the day, as it has been said by Professor Louis Godard yesterday, peace. Because peace is something that we have to build in the mind of people. Therefore, the transition is very natural, Professor. We are in China now, and it's a great pleasure to travel to Rome and to listen to your own final remarks. But on behalf of all of those involved, Professor, I would like to thank you very much because it has been, it's the third year now that you accompany us in this journey. As I said yesterday, COVID stopped many things, but while we were in this COVID period, we were able to continue to erect bridges. But it is not one person job, it's a team project, it's a team construction, and you are one of the main pillars of this construction, if not the main pillar. So thank you very much, Professor, and the floor is yours to conclude as you wish before we come back to Nankai and to listen to Professor Yu Xinchong.
Thank you very much indeed, Professor Gosset. But let me say that it's really a great honor and a great pleasure for me to be with you and to have the honor indeed to participate to this third dialogue, China, Europe, America Museums Cooperation Initiatives. I would like to spend a few words about the conclusions we could reach after these two very rich days. And I think we had the privilege of hearing eminent personalities from the world of culture, business, and politics talk about museum. I believe that the general consensus has emerged. The museum is not only a space open to history and beauty, it is also a privileged place where currents of thoughts from different universities meet. This makes the museum a window open to the world and therefore an instrument and the service of understanding between people. Professor Gosset, before the beginning of this
recording in progress.
We spoke about the Museum of Alexandria. Let me say that the museum as a space open to all the citizens was exactly what had in mind Pharaoh Ptolemy I Soter when he decided in 290 BC to create the grandiose Museum of Alexandria in Egypt. The museum was not only a space devoted to the masterpieces of art, but was also a center for research, science, literature, where searchers, writers, painters could dialogue with the people. After more than 2,000 years, we discover again the old ideal of the Hellenistic culture. And of course, today we are much more happy because we have the opportunity to use new technologies in order to help us to appreciate the beauty. And this has been said very clearly in these two last days. Every museum teaches us that there are no civilizations that have formed in a vacuum. A civilization is the product of exchanges in the field of art and science that have never taken borders into account. Culture has no borders. I like to evoke a phrase by Lucien Febvre about Europe. Everywhere, he wrote, we go from Europe to Asia and from Europe to Africa. This means that the history of Europe was made thanks to Asia and Africa, and of course, the reverse is true. The museums, by exhibiting the masterpieces from their reserves, underline, if we want to contemplate them with the eyes of the earth, the universal contribution that is at the center of any civilization. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor, and also for quoting Lucien Febvre on the deep connections between Eurasia and Africa, the Afro-Eurasian mega continent. And if Professor, the work we are doing can help some people to better appreciate beauty, as you have said, I think it will be already a great success, what we do. Before I give the floor to Professor Yin-Hsin Chung, it's time for me to thank the two wonderful interpreters who connected us during the 2 days, Mr. Huang Chihua and Ms. Ba. We love culture, but we love also languages. And to connect, the connection between languages and translation is absolutely essential. And I would like to thank both of you. I know that the interpretation was wonderful. We benefited from the great support of Nankai University, the president, Chen Lu, the wonderful students from the Faculty of History, wonderful professors of the Faculty of History. And I hope we can continue the cooperation. Of course, on the American side, I would like again to thank the Antiquities Coalition, Deborah Lair and Tess Davis. And in Beijing, the China International Communications Group, under which we have a wonderful think tank, and you have listened to Yun Xuan yesterday, and I think it was a very rich address that Yun Xuan pronounced. But of course, I would like also to thank my colleagues at DG2CI, each of them for doing a wonderful job, some in North America, Europe, Shanghai, but especially to thank Miss Lin Keya to be such elegant and intelligent colleague. Thank you, Miss Lin Keya. Now, Professor Yu-Hsin Chung, you will have the floor to conclude. And after you conclude, I will almost go directly to a short video I have prepared to take us in a gradual way towards 2024. We will see that in a minute, but Professor Yun-Hsin Chung, let me thank you for your trust, because I remember very, very well when I said, Professor Yu, let us work together. You did not hesitate. Your answer was immediate, and you said, let us cooperate and create a wonderful event. We did it. Thanks to you, Professor. Therefore, please make for all of us on our behalf the conclusion. Thank you, Professor.
各位先生，各位女士，大家下午好。非常荣幸有这个机会在最后的这个环节呢，来代表我们南开大学做一个简短的致辞。首先就是特别感谢咱们中美中欧美合作倡议和当代中国世界研究院来共同主办的这个博物馆文明对话之桥这样一个非常高端的论坛呢，能够落在和我们南开大学进行一个合作。 然后在我们南开大学设立线下的这个主会场，来让我们来自世界各地非常重要的学者和专家，以及这个博物馆的实践者，能够更好的来相聚在一起，开展这个跨国界的、跨文化的这样的一个交流。从而呢，也打开了给我们南开的这个博物馆学和这个文化的研究打开了一个新的这个窗户，推动我们更好的来学习、交流和对话。 我本人呢是南开大学历史学院的院长，我自己从事的研究主要是这个中国史，特别是明清的历史和中国的医学史。所以呢，我对博物馆本身我是一个外行，但是呢，听通过这两天的这个会议啊，这个对话，让我有很多的感慨，让我感觉到这样一个工作，这个博物馆的这样一个工作啊，和博物馆的这个交流啊，这个对于我们这个学术的发展和这个人类文明的进步啊，是其实是意义非常重大的。这我想这个博物馆既是这个历史与文化的一个载体，同时也是历史与文化的一个重新发明。它既是物质遗存，同时也是思想和精神的建构和重新阐发，还是一个比较独特的社会交往的一个空间。所以呢，我觉得这是一个非常重要的一个遗存啊，这是一个非常重要的一个机构。而且我想这也是我们现代文明的一个重要文明的一个重要的一个体现。如何更好的开展这个博物馆的一个建设和博物馆学的一个研究呢，其实是关系到我们现在的人类的生活，也关系到未来文明的发展和进步。所以对于这样一个在这里啊，我们举行这样一场对话，我感觉到这个能够参与这样一场对话呢，我感觉到非常的荣幸。这是一个方面。第二个方面呢，我觉得在通过这两天的学习啊，我找那个学习到了很多非常有意义的这个是那个关键词。比如说我们讲博物馆既是物，同时也要关注人。我想人永远是我们无论是历史研究也好，还是博物馆建设也好，永远是我们关注的一个核心。只有我们真正关心具象的人，是活生生的人，我们的历史的研究，我们博物馆的建设才会更具有活力。同时呢，我们这样一个中欧美的那个文明对话之桥的话呢，我想这里面有几个关键词啊，是大家一再都谈到的，一个是多元，一个是开放，一个是包容。我想在现在这样一个时代，要想更好的来消弭大家在不同文明之间的一个偏见，更好的实现人类的对话和共同进步的话，让人类拥抱同一个共同的文明，那这样的话，我们这样通过这种博物馆的形式来展开对话，来展开交流，来推动我们相互的理解、尊重与共同进步，那是非常重要的。我想，所以呢，我想通过好。所以我想通过这个博物馆这样一个相关的问题的这个交流啊，不仅可以实现文明的对话，可以促进文明的交流和融合，可以进而呢，可以更好的来促进这个人类文明的一个共通的一个进步。我想这个博物馆跟一般的物质还不太一样，这是一个可以跨越语言的这样的一个交流，所以呢，我想正是这个意义呢更加的巨大。在最后呢，我也想说一下，我们在开幕式上，我们的陈雨露校长已经跟大家简要的介绍了我们南开博物馆的建设的一个情况。南开大学是国内最早建立博物馆学专业的一个，中国最早建立博物馆专业的一个高校。这个有40年的时间里面呢，我们培养了博物馆界很多的人才。但是呢，我们现在这个发展呢，也还是距任重道远。我们现在的人员，这个博物馆的这个规模和这个学科的建设和发展，都存在着一个很大的一个空间。我们都知道，美国有近30,000家博物馆，有30,000多家博物馆，而中国有更多的人口，但是只有不到6,000家的博物馆。所以呢，对于中国未来的一个发展来讲，博物馆学的发展是可以想见是存在一个非常巨大的一个空间。所以在这种情况下，我想我对我们南开大学博物馆学专业来讲，是存在着一个非常重要的一个机会。 然后正是因为如此呢，我想我们这样一个对话，我们这样一个网上的线上的一个交流呢，是更具对我们这个学科的发展就更加具有意义和价值。我们南开博物馆的这个建设呢，除了我们一般所说的博物馆的一些特点以外，我觉得我们可能还有一个特点，我这里想跟大家做一个汇报，这就是我觉得我们南开大学的博物馆的建设啊，是建立在深厚的历史学研究的基础之上的。我们这个博物馆的那个设置呢，一开始就是从历史系的相关的老师分离出来的，然后呢，主要从事先秦、秦汉这样的一个研究。但是呢，不只是南开大学的博物馆的这个建设啊，除了关心中国的博物馆以外呢，其实从一开始就有我们美国史的教授加入其中，所以呢，也关心世界的博物馆的一个发展。所以我想这里面就正好符合我们南开大学的一个特点，古今贯通，中外交融。我们这个博物馆的建设后续呢，会更好的来推去发扬这样的一个传统，更好的把自己的博物馆的研究和建设呢，就建立在这个深厚的历史学的这样一个底蕴之上，同时更好的能够把古今和中外更好的交流和贯通起来。所以啊，我想后续呢，也希望我们各位像各在座的各位高塔的先生等等一系列的这个先生啊，对我那个这样的一些专家这样的非常高端的学者呢，能够给我们更多的指导和帮助。同时呢，也是真诚的期待啊，祝各位专家能够来南开来进行线下的指导和赐教。最后呢，我特别要感谢高塔的那个高大伟先生所带领的团队为这一次这个会议这次对话所做出的非常卓越的这个努力。同时呢，也要感谢我们这个袁胜文老师带队的我们南开大学的这个那个老师的这个团队呢，为此付出的这个努力，也为我们开始在网络上出现的一些问题呢表示真诚的道歉。这希望呢，我们以后呢就能够更好的来做这样的一个工作，也希望我们和高大伟团队这个的未来的合作呢能够有更广阔的一个空间。最后啊，再次感谢大家，也预祝我们第下一次的这个对话，我们下一次的合作呢更加的愉快，更具有成效。最后祝大家身体健康，万事如意，谢谢大家。
非常感谢于教授 ，Thank you so much, Professor Yu. I have thanked the people I wanted to thank, and now we will show you a very, very brief video of 2 minutes. And I am thinking already about you, dear Juan, Mr. Juan Gabarón, because you will see that we are going to end in Spain. But I think it's much more than Spain, and it will take us also to next year. And after this video, there will be no more. It will be the end of our third dialogue. So let us see what comes next.
It's time to end our third dialogue. I wanted to end with a short video. It seems stimulating to be meaningful. Artist Yves Sussman imagines what precedes the moment painted by Velázquez in his masterpiece Las Meninas. In the master's studio, there is a collection of paintings, already a museum. A collection of paintings which nourishes the inspiration of the greatest painter of the Spanish Golden Age, but which he also transcends. I am well aware of the work that led to our forum. It started 3 years ago. I would like to thank all our partners and each of my colleagues for their support and trust. Dear friends, the work that will lead to our next meeting begins tomorrow. Let us meet on May 22nd and 23rd of 2024 around the theme, the role of museums in fostering creativity. Thank you.